Welcome to the hearing of the subcommittee on the issue of transparency and accounting for what are frequently called alternative assets in defined benefit plans. We're very happy to have an excellent panel. I want to thank my ranking member and friend, Dr. Price, for his cooperation and participation, and welcome the ladies and gentlemen of the public. Noting that a quorum is present, the hearing of the committee will come to order. 86 million Americans depend on traditional defined benefit plans for their future income. As the great work of the General Accountability Office has shown in 2008, led by Ms. Boberg, who's with us this morning, the number of pension plans that are investing in hedge funds and private equity funds is growing rather precipitously. Upwards of about 91%, I believe the GAO study says, are involved in hedge funds, and a slightly smaller number in private equity. I may have that reversed, but it's a growing, it is set 91 in private equity, and I think 70 in hedge funds it is now, or a number close to that. And if, although one cannot be exact about the level of investment in those funds, it's certainly in the hundreds of millions of billions of dollars. And of course, similar choices are being made by individuals in defined contribution plans as well. I want to say emphatically from the beginning, I think the most important principle governing fiduciary decision making in defined benefit plans is diversification of assets. I think that a prudent fiduciary is someone who understands well the diversification of risk and reward. Given that principle, I am not in any way interested in any statutory or arbitrary limitation on investments in such assets for pension funds or anyone else. I don't think it's the job of elected officials to favor or disfavor any class of investments. I think we should be agnostic as to classes of investments. I think that we should write laws that impose high standards of fiduciary responsibility on those whose job it is to make those decisions. And I think we should then essentially get out of the way and let them exercise their fiduciary duty. In order for people to exercise their fiduciary duty in a proper way, transparency is needed. In other words, one cannot really understand the potential risks and rewards of an investment if the data which underlie the dynamics of that investment are not easily and readily understandable. In most cases, most classes of investments have a long history of regulatory disclosure and, frankly, have a measure of transparency that comes from the principle that in a marketplace, people vote with their feet. So when one invests in a frequently traded public stock or public bond, market fluctuations, when one sees millions of shares traded or billions of transactions occur, will let one know what one's peers think about the value of an asset. That kind of information is not readily available when it comes to alternative investments. They are typically thinly traded. In many cases, they are illiquid. In many cases, there may be no market at all that would help one determine what the marketplace thinks about the value of an asset. Again, I emphatically believe that this phenomenon should not exclude these classes of assets from consideration by fiduciary trustees and defined benefit plans. I don't think that at all. But I certainly think that those fiduciaries ought to have ample information to real-time relevant information so they can properly discharge their responsibilities as fiduciaries. This, I believe, is not an ideological or political question. It is an empirical and analytical one. And that the purpose of this morning's hearings is to assemble four individuals who have great experience in this area, and I believe great expertise in this area, and we welcome them to the subcommittee. The questions we're interested in hearing about this morning are, what tools are presently available to pension plan fiduciaries in evaluating alternative investments? How complete or incomplete are these tools? How useful are these tools? What might supplement them and make them more useful? What rules and standards govern those who prepare these tools? When one relies on an audited financial statement from a hedge fund or private equity fund to make a fiduciary decision, What standards would govern the quality of that audited financial statement? What do we know about the competence and preparation of the preparer? If there were conflicts of interest, what standards or rules would at least disclose or hopefully prohibit such a conflict of interest? The purpose of this hearing is for those of us on the committee to get a sense of how those who are in this fiduciary world view the efficacy of the tools that are available to them, and to evaluate whether, if at all, changes are necessary to public policy. I want to say from the outset, I believe that public policy does not necessarily mean statutes or regulations. It can come in the form of guidance from the Department of Labor. It could come in other less formal iterations. But at the end of the day, here is what we're interested in achieving. We want to develop a body of knowledge that would give us a level of assurance that when fiduciaries are carrying out their fiduciary responsibility and making a decision to invest or not invest in pension funds, in a private equity fund or hedge fund, that that decision is being made in full disclosure, that that decision is being made with the benefit of tools that would help one evaluate the true value of that asset, so that in diversifying one's portfolio, the fiduciary can make the best decision for those who depend on that decision. Our interest here is obviously beyond the philosophical and academic. Our real agenda is to prevent from ever occurring a taxpayer-subsidized bailout of pension funds. Our concern here is that to some extent explicitly and to some extent implicitly, the taxpayers of the United States stand behind defined benefit plans in our country. So we not only have an interest in fairness for those who depend on those funds for their income, but we certainly have an interest in protecting the taxpayers of the country against any sort of obligation that would require them to rescue a failed fund. The best defense against failure is diversification. The best principle of diversification is transparent understanding the investments through which a fiduciary can invest or not invest. So that's the purpose of our hearing. I'd like to proceed by turning to my friend, the senior Republican on the subcommittee, Dr. Price, for his opening comments, at which time we will then proceed to hear from the witnesses.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate you holding this hearing. I want to thank also the members of the panel. We look forward to your comments today and appreciate you taking the time to share with us your expertise. This is a remarkably critical issue. Some pension plans are experiencing funding shortfalls after the economic downturn, and plan sponsors are trying to find greater returns to meet their obligations. However, I share with some of my colleagues the concern that today we will be hearing testimony and recommendations, some of which are based upon a government report that's almost 2 years old. That's essentially before the financial crisis occurred and without any of the recent statutory changes made in the Dodd-Frank Act, which candidly will have huge consequences, many of which may not be helpful to the state of pensions. Nevertheless, we welcome the opportunity to look at this issue further in an effort to better understand any potential problems. The ERISA statute provides a long-standing framework to guide the activities of private pension plans and the people acting in a fiduciary capacity for those plans. Generally, a pension plan fiduciary, the person charged with running the plan and making those pivotal decisions, must act prudently in determining a pension plan's obligations and ensure that sufficient assets exist to meet those obligations. Part of that obligation includes making good investment decisions. Pension plans commonly spread their investments across a wide variety of investment vehicles, stocks, bonds, mutual funds. Diversification helps pension plans avoid catastrophic losses and helps secure reasonable rates of return. Congress has historically encouraged diversification of pension assets and has mostly avoided mandating how private pensions invest their assets, leaving many of those details to those financial professionals responsible for the pension plans. As we'll hear today, there are many different ways to invest pension assets, including some non-traditional vehicles such as hedge funds and private equity. We'll learn about different types of alternative products, how they operate and help pension plans achieve their objectives, whether our witnesses believe that new regulations are advisable, how different states may enable or curtail pension plan investment in alternative products, and whether the new financial services law might shed some light on the operations of certain funds like hedge funds. When looking at the bigger picture, though, it's important to note that our economic system generally provides greater rewards and potentially greater losses for those who take greater risks. Now, the vast majority of pension investments are made in a highly sophisticated financial advisors, investing in good faith and legitimate private investment funds. This ultimately helps all pensioners receive their promised benefits. Have there been some bad actors? Absolutely. However, we should be careful at this hearing not to implicate an entire industry due to the conduct of a small number of unscrupulous individuals. These issues are too important and consequential to the majority of Americans to rush to action or draw incorrect conclusions that might limit the choices for pensioners or flexibility in their decision making. Mr. Chairman, I thank you, and I look forward to our hearing and hearing from the witnesses and the questions that will follow.
I thank my friend, and without objection, opening statements from any other member of the subcommittee will be entered in the record at this point. We'll now proceed to introduce the witnesses. I'm going to read a brief biography for each of you. You should know that your written statements, which we have received in advance and appreciate, will be entered without objection into the record of the hearing. We'd ask you to provide us with an approximately 5-minute oral summary of that written statement so that we can then proceed to the question and answer session with the members of the committee. So I'm going to read the biographies in order of the witness's testimony, and then we'll proceed. Mr. Matthew D. Hutchison is an independent pension fiduciary. His clients include the plans of Fortune 100, 500, and 1,000 companies, mid and small size companies, government and legal accounting firms. Mr. Hutchison received his MS from the Institute of Business and Finance and earned further accreditation from the University of Pittsburgh, Texas Tech University, and the American Academy of Financial Management. Mr. Hutchison, welcome to the committee. We're pleased to welcome back Ms. Barbara D. Bovberg, who's the Director of Education, Workforce, and Income Security Issues at the United States Government Accountability Office. At the GAO, she oversees evaluative studies on age and retirement income policy issues, including Social Security, private pension programs, and other issues. Ms. Bovberg holds a master's degree in public policy from Cornell University, an outstanding school, and a BA from Oberlin College. You can guess that both Mr. Walker and myself are graduates of Cornell Law School. So it's not the only reason that you're here. We're pleased to welcome back to the committee Mr. Robert Chambers, a partner at McGuire Woods LLP. Mr. Chambers counsels employers and executives in connection with tax-qualified retirement plans, including 401k plans, cash balance and pension equity plans, and ESOPs. He received his JD from Villanova University Law School and a BA from Princeton University, located in the finest state in America, New Jersey. We appreciate that, Mr. Chambers. Mr. Holt, I'm sure, would appreciate that as well, since he represents Princeton. And finally, Mr. John Marco is chairman of the Marco Consulting Group. He began his career as an investment consultant in 1977 when he joined A.G. Becker Incorporated. Mr. Marco received his B.S. in mathematics from Lewis University and continued his graduate studies at Purdue, Northwestern, and Northern Illinois Universities. We welcome to each of our witnesses, welcome to the subcommittee. Three of you I know have been here before. I think, Mr. Hutchison, this is your rookie appearance here. Is that right? The way the rules work is that in front of you, you see a box. When you begin your testimony, the green light will go on. When you have 1 minute left in your five, the yellow light will go on. And the red light signifies the end of the 5 minutes. We'd ask you to summarize so we can get to questions. And so, Mr. Hutchison, if you turn your microphone on, we will begin with you. We welcome you to the committee.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. Chairman Andrews, Congressman Price, and members of the committee, my name is Matthew Hutchison. I'm a professional independent fiduciary. Retirement plan sponsors may appoint me to serve as the responsible decision maker for their plans to fulfill those often complex and time-consuming obligations. In my role as fiduciary, I've made decisions directly affecting the lives of hundreds of thousands of plan participants, of hopeful retirees expecting to receive many billions worth of future benefits. We live in an increasingly volatile and uncertain business world. As a result, many plan fiduciaries are exploring alternative investments to improve portfolio performance and reduce risks. It is likely that interest in alternative investments will continue to spread, not only for the potential merit of the alternative investment alone, but particularly due to concerns about the economy and Wall Street's integrity, even in the face of sweeping legislative reform. There is significant financial industry fatigue, and alternative investments offer a sense of hope for some. Generally speaking, an alternative investment means any investment vehicle except stocks, bonds, mutual funds, or similar funds comparable to mutual funds, cash, or property. Examples of alternative investments may include tangible assets such as gold or art, commodities, private equity funds, hedge funds, and closely held stocks. Other examples of alternative investments, although not usually referred to as such, are derivatives and guru portfolios. Derivatives are those speculative instruments that brought down Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns and nearly destroyed our financial system. Guru portfolios are so-called investment strategies based on special knowledge and expertise the guru is purported to have. That is how the guru claims it can outperform its competitors. Gurus play to the investor's ego, making the investor feel special and smart for knowing the guru and for being permitted to invest with him or her. Many times, the guru is falsifying accounting records to make the investment performance appear better than it is. Investors' attention becomes focused on short-term gains instead of long-term values. Bernie Madoff is the most famous example. The due diligence burden retirement plan fiduciaries have when investigating alternative investments is significantly higher than it is for publicly traded securities, for obvious reasons. It requires greater knowledge and insight into relevant issues. Most fiduciaries of employer-sponsored plans are ill-prepared to perform an appropriate level of due diligence. While the plan itself is considered to be an accredited investor, individual fiduciaries might not otherwise be. The participants in a plan are vulnerable to the decisions made by that fiduciary. There are several reasons that performing due diligence and proper monitoring of alternative investments is so difficult. First, the fair value of the investment may be difficult to determine. Even when a fair value is assigned to an investment, its validity may be subject to debate. For example, the reported fair value of an investment could reasonably change by changing one or more unobservable inputs that could have a reasonably material impact in calculating the fair value under those circumstances. Unobservable inputs are assumptions the investment manager makes based on what he or she believes potential investors will pay for an interest in that investment. Those assumptions are based upon the best information available at the time and given specific circumstances affecting that investment. However, there may be multiple unobservable inputs that are equally valid that materially change the calculated fair market value. There are other reasons for performing due diligence on alternative investments is tricky for fiduciaries. One is limited historical information. The second is the difficulty in obtaining an expected return, which is the basis of capital markets. Without an expected return, fiduciaries are unable to determine the merit of a particular investment. In order to properly govern a retirement plan, the portfolio must be structured in such a way as to produce that expected return in a diversified portfolio. So there are four practical ways to protect retirement plan participants from the inherent accounting, valuation, and due diligence challenges provided within the alternative investment framework. First, require audit of internal controls that are normally required for publicly traded companies. Require them for hedge funds and private equity funds. Number two, require understandable financial statements. We receive financial statements that are frequently difficult to understand. Number three, ensure that managers of alternative investments have solid enterprise risk management skills. And finally, improving fair value measurement methods, and I will explore all of these in greater detail throughout the hearing.
Mr. Hutchison, thank you. You should be aware of the fact the members have had your written testimony and had ample time to read it. I read it, and so you can assume that we've had the opportunity to hear your complete statement. Thank you. Ms. Bilberg, welcome back to the committee. Thank you again for the outstanding work the GAO does on a range of issues across the country and across the issues. I am always impressed by the thoroughness and dedication you and your colleagues show to every question you confront. It's good to have you back.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. I'll report back on your kind remarks. I'm particularly pleased to be here today to speak about pension plan investment in hedge funds and private equity. It's such an important issue. Millions of Americans rely on defined benefit plans for their financial well-being and retirement. And it's particularly important that plan fiduciaries choose wisely in investing plan assets to assure the plans are adequately funded today and in the future. My testimony focuses on the extent to which plans have invested in hedge funds and private equity, the challenges they face in making such investments, steps sponsors can take to address the challenges, and measures government can take. My statement updates our 2008 report on this topic. First, the extent of these investments. The frequency of DB plan investment in hedge funds has grown dramatically, with 51% of large plans holding hedge funds in their portfolios today, up from 11% in 2001. Yet the vast majority of these plans invest less than 10% of their assets this way. The picture is a little different for private equity investment. Although 90% of large plans invest in private equity today, over 70% of them did this in 2001, so this type of investment has been consistently fairly common, at least among large plans. But as with hedge funds, most plans do not concentrate their assets in this form of investment. Let me turn now to the challenges these investments present. Although plan fiduciaries have told us that they invest this way to diversify while gaining potentially significant returns, they face several major challenges. Foremost, the uncertainty over the current value of their investment. Unlike stocks and bonds, which have a readily determined market price, hedge fund and private equity investments are more opaque to investors. Hedge funds generally do not provide information on either the nature of the underlying holdings or the aggregate value on a day-to-day basis. Hedge fund managers may decline to disclose information on asset holdings and their value if they believe the disclosure could compromise their trading strategy. Similarly, private equity investment valuation is often uncertain during the fund cycle, which can be up to 10 years or more. Plan fiduciaries often won't know the value of the underlying investment until the holdings are sold. Investment risks are also greater than for more traditional investments. For example, hedge fund and private equity managers may make relatively unrestricted use of leverage. While leverage can magnify profits, it can also magnify losses. Further, the success or failure of these funds can be greatly affected by their managers. And obviously, a managerial investment mistake can cause losses, but there are also operational risks of mismanagement, such as internal control weaknesses that open the door to fraud. And this underlines the importance of annual audits, which encourage robust operational and internal control processes. Finally, these investments are generally illiquid, making it difficult, if not impossible, for plans to cut their losses in the event of mishap. While the DB plan sponsor is responsible for assuring plan funding levels, not the participant, as with 401ks, a significant drop in funding could ultimately affect the viability of the DB plan, and by extension, the retirement benefits participants have been promised. Plan fiduciaries told us they take measures to protect themselves from these risks by making careful and deliberate fund selection at the front end. But of course, the success of this approach depends on how good the fiduciaries are at such decision making and how much information they have going in. Savvy fiduciaries negotiate key terms of investments with these funds, specifying fee structuring conditions, valuation procedures, redemption provisions, and degree of leverage to be employed. Some told us they look to funds of funds to expand their diversification, although these are often less transparent than single hedge funds and can come with an additional layer of fees. So there's a lot to be considered as a plan fiduciary seeking to invest in such funds, and we think the federal government can help. In 2008, 2 years ago, we recommended the Department of Labor provide guidance on the unique challenges of these investments and outline prudent steps plan fiduciaries could take. We felt this could help all plans that consider such investments, and in fact might warn smaller plans away if they don't have the resources to carry out the oversight that is needed. We still believe that this would be an important contribution for the department to make, but although they said they would consider the feasibility of our recommendation, they've taken no action as yet. I'd like to conclude by noting that plan sponsors are facing tremendous financial pressures, both overall and in maintaining funding levels in their DB plans. Congress has provided temporary relief from ERISA funding rules, but the pressure to achieve high returns on plan assets has got to be significant, especially if a failure to achieve such returns means higher required contributions from the sponsor. It will be increasingly important to help fiduciaries do the right thing by making them aware of the risks associated with alternative investments, as well as ways to manage their stake in these investments. Guidance from labor and better information from the investment managers themselves cannot, of course, protect plan assets from poor decision making, but it can better armor fiduciaries and, by extension, plan participants against large losses resulting from a poor understanding of what they're getting into. And that concludes my statement, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you again, Ms. Boeber. Mr. Chambers, welcome back to the committee. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Price, and members of the committee. First and foremost, let me express my profound appreciation to the committee for an opportunity to spend a few hours thinking about something other than health reform. It's been terrific. But I also appreciate the opportunity to present testimony with respect to the investment of DB plan assets in hedge funds, private equity funds, and other alternative investments. DB plans must continue to provide participants with promised retirement security despite these turbulent economic times. Our national priority should be a DB plan system that functions transparently, as you indicated, Mr. Chairman, and provides promised benefits, but without non-essential administrative burdens and unnecessary costs that would undermine their essential purpose. So I'm going to make a few points, if I may. The first relates to the GAO report from 2008 on the investment of DB plan assets in these kinds of investments. I think that the GAO report itself was something of a hedge, and I think that it was an important position for them to take, and I think that it was actually pretty smart. The report took great care, as did Ms. Boeber just now, to describe both the challenges and the unique opportunities presented by these types of investments. So, for example, she indicated, and the report indicated, that a growing number of plans have begun to invest in hedge funds and private equity, but virtually all of them have invested only a small portion of their total plan assets. Similarly, while many hedge fund and private equity investments may carry increased risks, virtually all the fiduciaries interviewed indicated that they were generally pleased with the overall results of those investments and that they were willing to devote the necessary time and energy to vet those investments in order to increase overall asset returns and, of course, to reduce volatility. The GAO report did not suggest that any restrictions be placed on non-traditional investments by DB plans or that additional protective legislation would be required. Instead, it recommended that DOL apprise plan fiduciaries of the risks of such investments and the need for increased due diligence, negotiations, and monitoring in accordance with ERISA's existing fiduciary rules. Which leads to my second point, and that is that the guidance that the GAO has suggested is generally available currently from other sources. The DOL expressed concern that providing this guidance would be difficult in light of the lack of uniformity in those investments, but I think that help is on the way. First, the SEC is likely to provide help as it issues regulations and other guidance under the Dodd-Frank Financial Reform Bill. And in the interim, the DOL could easily make available to plan fiduciaries the existing work of, frankly, many sophisticated nonpartisan groups that have developed excellent tools for handling the due diligence and contract negotiations for these kinds of investments. And I've referred to one of these reports in my written testimony. My third point is that the Dodd-Frank bill will require many plan advisors to register with the SEC and to provide information regarding their funds. The bill will give the SEC broad new powers with respect to managers of many hedge funds and possibly private equity funds. And the SEC and FSOC and other regulators will provide guidance on definitions, registration requirements, and the periodic filing of confidential information for many of these funds. In light of the recent passage of the bill, neither Congress nor the DOL should act at this time, in my view, to restrict DB plans from investing in these kinds of funds. And next, there are the valuation issues that others have already addressed, and I think that these valuation issues are, in fact, being addressed. Form 5500 and plan actuaries require an annual determination of the fair market value of DB plan assets. So all investments for which there's no public market or reported unit sales, including hedge funds and private equity funds, present valuation challenges that I think are manageable, albeit somewhat thorny. Other groups are working on the issue. Again, the SEC is likely to develop valuation techniques as part of its guidance under the Dodd-Frank bill, and also the Financial Accounting Standards Board and the accounting industry are developing a systematized approach to the valuation of downstream investments for which there's no public market. My last point is that plan participants do not need additional information on any of these kinds of investments either. Again, the Pension Protection Act requires defined benefit plan administrators to provide annual funding notices to participants that include a year-end market valuation of the plan's assets and liabilities, as well as information regarding funding and investment policies. The DOL has already issued a model notice that's relatively short and easy, I think, for participants to understand. I don't believe that there's any need to provide even more information that could render the existing disclosure regime completely meaningless. And one last thought, if I may. The DOL has consistently advised plan sponsors and other fiduciaries of the importance of process. You're supposed to create appropriate procedures, follow the procedures, review the procedures from time to time to determine that they remain best practices, and then document your compliance and review. Fiduciaries are to be judged primarily on their adherence to this process rather than on the result of their individual decisions. And the decision whether to invest DB assets in hedge funds or other alternative investments, as well as the monitoring in those investments, should not be held to a different standard. Thank you.
Mr. Chambers, thank you very much for your testimony. Mr. Marco, welcome to the committee. We're happy that you're with us.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Price, and members of the committee. My name is Jack Marco. I'm the chairman of the Marco Consulting Group, an investment consulting firm. I founded in 1988. We serve about 400 defined benefit plans as clients. Most are multi-employer, jointly trusteed plans organized under the Taft-Hartley Act and subject to ERISA. In most cases, we serve as an investment consultant, but in many situations, we serve as a named fiduciary where we make the decisions on asset allocation and select investment managers. Our clients' aggregate value is approximately $90 billion. The employee trustees of the Taft-Hartley plans are electricians and bakers, bricklayers and nurses, janitors and plumbers. They work in our grocery stores and hotels and hospitals. They drive trucks and make clothes and care for the sick. They are the very best our nation has for building complex construction projects and providing necessary and sometimes critical services. The employer trustees represent small business and large. They are contractors, HR specialists, labor relations specialists, and representatives of trade associations. While they are not investment professionals, as leaders in their unions and businesses, they are smart, successful, accomplished individuals. As trustees, they work tirelessly to provide a solid retirement benefit for their members and their employees, and they accept all of the liabilities of a fiduciary and receive no compensation. When I first started providing investment consulting services to Taft-Hartley plans in 1977, their investments were overwhelmingly in traditional assets of stocks, bonds, insurance contracts. I was hired as an investment consultant to help them select and monitor investment firms which would manage their assets. Their investments in publicly traded stocks and bonds were held at a custodian bank and independently valued by them. There was little debate about what they owned, what it was worth, and the risks they were taking. Today, our clients still own stocks and bonds held in many of the same custodial banks. However, these assets represent about 75% of their funds. The remainders are in real estate partnerships and commingled funds, private equity partnerships, LLCs, and hedge funds. On the positive side, these assets have added important diversification to the portfolios and improved returns. On the negative side, many of these strategies have become very complex with little regulation and government oversight. The trustees are expected to be prudent experts when selecting investments which use these strategies. More than ever, they rely on independent investment consulting firms such as ours to educate them on the risks and returns of these approaches, bring them the best managers, and help them avoid the poor ones. That is becoming more challenging every day. I would like to focus on two of these investment approaches, private equity and hedge funds. In private equity, the definition of private means making investments in companies that are not registered with the SEC as publicly traded securities. They are not generally followed by Wall Street. One of the advantages of private equities is that little is known about these startup companies or privately held institutions. Therefore, investors who seek out these companies have greater opportunities for superior return. It's also true that this same lack of information creates risk to investors. While a manager of publicly traded equity may hold 50 securities, some private equity managers will hold less than 10 investments. These private equity investments are typically partnerships, the investment manager being the general partner and the pension fund being the limited partner. At the time of investment, there are no investments made yet, and the manager begins the process of looking for companies in which to invest. The investor has to rely on his own due diligence and information provided by the general partner to provide some confidence that the general partner will do well. Our clients typically meet four times a year to conduct all of the business of the pension fund. They have no capacity and no investment staff to perform that due diligence. Most often, they look to an investment consultant to provide that due diligence for them. Our process examines private equity managers in great detail, everything from SEC registration, third-party providers, offering memorandums, marketing materials, and the like. We require this information to proceed. However, the general partners are not required to provide it. If they refuse, we move on to another candidate. The general partner moves on to another investor who may not demand these disclosures. The best general partners provide all that is asked of them and more. The worst general partners rely on slick presentations without appropriate disclosure. The same can be said about disclosures after the pension fund has become an investor. Again, all of these requirements we place on any partnership we recommend to our clients. This is not demanded by the investor. Where it is not demanded by the investor, it may not be provided because it is not required by law. Our preference is for our clients to use private equity fund of funds instead of individual private equity funds. The fund of fund structure provides diversification of strategy, geography, and industry. The fund of funds manager brings expertise, access, and oversight and resources the investment process and bears full responsibility for the evaluation, selection, timing of all of these investments. We believe this due diligence structure and the use of fund of funds is a very effective tool for Taft-Hartley trustees. However, requiring general partners to provide these disclosures would ensure that all investors have the information they need to make intelligent, informed decisions. On hedge funds, there are over 9,000 hedge funds available for pension fund investors. They include a multitude of strategies, long, short equity, merger arbitrage, relative value, distressed debt, fixed income arbitrage, and the list goes on. These are some of the most sophisticated strategies executed in the industry. Consequently, it requires equally sophisticated supervision. That is why we prefer funds of hedge funds for our clients. These are typically partnerships or LLCs that select a group of hedge funds and move in and out of them over time. The investor then owns shares in 30 to 50 hedge funds in a diversified portfolio rather than just a few they would select on their own. As a result, we focus our analyzing and monitoring on funds of hedge funds. We have developed a list of best practices for funds of hedge funds. Generally, we do not recommend funds of hedge funds that do not adhere to the majority of the best practices. We also expect fund of hedge fund managers to follow certain best practices in its due diligence and monitoring underlying hedge funds. Our best practices are divided into four categories: people, investment, operational, and business. Let me just mention that one of the key things about people, background checks, history, experience, and operational risk is something that's very key to us. We think the funds need to hire third-party firms to manage custody, audit, and administration responsibility. We want to also measure the business risk of these institutions. Let me make clear that these are best practices we believe are appropriate and that we follow. They are not required by law or in regulation. Finally, we believe the SEC registration should be required for all hedge funds and funds of hedge funds, and thus we welcome Congress's passage of the Financial Reform Bill requiring registration of those funds with $150 million or more under management as an important step towards that goal. In conclusion, I'd like to say the investment environment that Taft-Hartley Fund trustees face today is exponentially more complex than it was when I joined the industry three decades ago. It's very difficult to expect trustees to understand the many investment strategies, but without full and complete disclosure by the investment community, it is nearly impossible for these trustees to do their job in protecting the retirement security of millions of American workers. From the professional advisor and fiduciary's perspective, I know requiring these disclosure would help us do a better job of scrutinizing these investments. I've also provided the committee with a list of these best practices on private equity and hedge funds on the website provided to the committee. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Marco. We'd like to thank each of our witnesses for their preparation. Excellent presentations this morning. We'll now get to the questions from the members. Mr. Hutchison, let's assume that I'm a fiduciary of a defined benefit plan, and I'm thinking about making an investment with my fellow trustees in a private equity fund that buys bad debt. And the business principle of the private equity fund is that they think that people have undervalued this bad debt, that it's worth more than that they were able to buy it for, and they're going to make a profit off of that. Let me just walk through some of the resources available now for me to help make the decision as to whether or not that's a good or bad decision for the people to whom I have a fiduciary duty. First of all, I assume that on the basic level, if someone were stealing from that fund, that a competent accountant would find that. Is that correct?
Most of the time, embezzlement would be discovered.
Okay. Now let's get beyond that to the more common sort of problem. When I look at the financial statement of this private equity fund, it's going to list on it assets of the debts owned by, right? The debts owned by the private equity fund are going to be listed as assets. Who would do the valuation of those assets on that financial statement?
Well, there should be an independent audit performed of the fund, and there could be, depending on the nature, where the debt came from. If the debt is from publicly traded companies, which it could be, in the underlying private equity fund, there should be a Sarbanes-Oxley.
Let's assume it's bad real estate loans. Let's assume that it's bad real estate loans that the fund has bought from banks. Mm-hmm.
Well, the fund will hire an auditor, they call them internal auditors, to perform an audit and put together the financial statement. We may not know what the probability is.
Would we know, and I don't ask this as an accusatory question, mm-hmm. If the auditor who did that audit, if it was the first time he or she had ever evaluated bad debt, mm-hmm. would we know that?
No, you would not know
If
that.
They had done it 1,000 times, would we know that?
No.
Yeah. If, as my friend suggests, if we asked, either you or Mr. Marco could answer this question, is that the type of information that would typically be made available if you asked for it?
If the fiduciary, if it occurs to the fiduciary to ask that question, which it should, they might share that with you. But that's a question that most fiduciaries wouldn't occur to them to ask that question.
What other documents might the fiduciary rely upon to determine whether to buy into that fund, mm-hmm. besides the audited financial statement?
Well, drilling down a little bit in greater detail, the probability that the debts are actually going to be paid off and why they think that, there needs to be some type of a risk measurement tied to each one of the debt obligations, so the understanding what the nature of the debt is, what the payment terms are, what the interest rates are. There's a large variety of things that go into investigating such a portfolio. It's very complex.
Mr. Marco, in your work, both acting as a fiduciary and advising fiduciaries, if you were presented with the hypothetical that I gave, what kind of due diligence would you perform in order to either make the decision or give advice about making the decision about that bad debt fund?
The first step is, before it starts, when you evaluate whether or not you want to hire that investment manager to manage those assets, the due diligence requires, what is the process that you use to price securities? Is there a methodology? Are there outside mm-hmm. independent auditors? Are you applying FASB standards? All of these are questions you have to ask before you start the investment. And if the answers are to your satisfaction, if they are complete, then afterwards, then it's asking the question when the assets are checking to make sure they're continuing to follow their practices. But it's the first step requiring those things, and those are the things I described as best practices. That's what a good firm would do. And if they're doing it, then that's fine. My view is that it ought to be required. It ought not be just, you know, someone saying, you know, because, again, my argument is that if we follow those and we recommend or select those funds that do that kind of appropriate due diligence, we're comfortable. But those that don't, we don't recommend or don't use. They move on to the next investor and they get their money because they didn't ask the question, they didn't pursue it. It's much more satisfactory if they're required to provide it right up front, then you'll know, because once the investment's made, once you've given the money to the investment manager and you have that bad debt, you own it. Now it's a problem you have to deal with. You avoid it up front if you have the right procedure.
Mr. Chambers, one of the points you noted in your testimony was about the date of the GAO report we're talking about this morning. And in fairness to the GAO, obviously, we haven't asked them to do anything since that time. They were asked at that time to issue their report. And I would want the record to show that, yeah, I think that before any decisions could be made based on that report, it would need to be updated rather considerably given what's happened since the report was written. If we were to look at areas of inquiry that we think the GAO should do to follow up on the work it did in 2008, what kinds of questions do you think that we should ask them to look at?
Well, I think to some extent they have updated their report. And I think that the result of the update of their report is that, at least as I glanced through it last night, it had the recommendations and the findings had not changed materially since the report in 2008. I think that what they were doing is they were looking at, again, process. They're not suggesting regulation. They're not suggesting legislation. They're looking at process. They're focusing on perhaps the Department of Labor coming out with guidance rather than regulation on what types of best practices are out there. What I would suggest to Mr. Marco is, in connection with his last response, is that what he perceives to be a best practice in conjunction with a particular type of investment fund is it's going to be very different, perhaps, than what Mr. Hutchinson's best practice would be, and
or
certainly
yours.
Than mine, because of course I don't have any. I'm just a lawyer. but I do think that the best practices are going to be very complicated to create a definite finite group of best practices, because it's going to differ from investment to investment. Some of them, of course, will overlap.
Ms. Boberg, what, and this will be my last question, what do you think the logical next series of questions we might ask that you could build on the work that you've done?
I think it would be really useful to know what's going on in the small plan universe, and that is a much harder thing to uncover. The concern that we had in doing this report, when we talked with representatives of large plans, they had a strategy and they understood what they needed to do and talked about the challenges and how they were dealing with them, very competent people who had thought about this a great deal. What we see is an increase in plans of the large and medium sizes going into hedge funds and private equity. What that suggests is likely smaller plans will follow. There, and I don't mean this in a pejorative way, but there is a sort of a herd mentality among plan investors. They don't want to be the outlier necessarily. And you could imagine a smaller plan coming to the conclusion that they're not being a very good fiduciary and they're not getting the returns that they should be getting because they're not doing this too. And they really may not be capable of providing the kind of oversight that is needed. So that was a concern we had, and the work we did in the last couple of weeks looking for this hearing, looking at the data, suggested that the trend continues, and work we have underway in another area that touches on this doesn't in any way suggest that things are materially different.
I appreciate that. Thank each of you, and I would turn to Dr. Price for his questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to pick up where that discussion was leaving off. Mr. Marco, the GAO report talked about some states that had limited small plans to investment categories. The small plans under $250 million, for example, unable to invest in hedge funds or private equity at a state level. Is there merit to considering that at the federal level?
I do think there is some merit in that. The issue is this. Very small plans, the question is they have the wherewithal to hire the professionals to help them do the work. Small plans, almost by definition, don't have internal investment staff. So they don't have people, so they can go outside and hire investment consulting firms to do that work for them. Very small plans can't afford to do that. So they are left then with individuals who may not be investment professionals, but fiduciaries of these plans to go out and make decisions on very complex information. As I said, where disclosure is not required, And even if it was, their level of handling it can be very difficult.
Mr. Hutchison, do you agree with that? That there's merit to having the federal government consider limiting what small plans can do?
I agree with Chairman Andrews that the federal government probably should not go there with respect to limiting. I think that Mr. Chambers said that perhaps some guidance from the government on what would be required for alternative investments would be appropriate. In the current small plan world, we have investment fiduciaries who get paid a percentage of assets, so there's a small percentage that's paid off the top that can be easily liquidated and paid to an investment advisor. In the small plan world, that it becomes difficult to have an investment advisor involved to monitor because you can't just liquidate the alternative investment to pay a fee. The small plan sponsor has to pay it out of their own pocket, and so it becomes problematic to, number one, get expertise in monitoring and evaluating. However, I don't think that they should be limited. I think that fiduciaries simply need to understand that the burden, the due diligence burden, and the monitoring burden is significant, and it requires true expertise.
Ms. Boberg, you commented to in response to the chairman's question about what you might want to consider for a new report. Given the recent passage of the reg reform bill and the regulations that will certainly be forthcoming from the SEC and elsewhere, would it not be wise for Congress to and the Department of Labor to wait until we see what other arms of the federal government are going to do and require before issuing any recommendations?
Well, we have never called for a requirement that would limit the types of investments.
No, I'm talking in a different kind of a different umbrella. Just in terms of your report, the chairman asked you about your report. Would it not be appropriate for us to wait until we see what the SEC and others are doing as in response to the reg reform bill?
It is our hope that Labor and SEC will work together as they consider these things. There's always that difficulty of who's the investor. You know, SEC is protecting investors. Labor is protecting plan participants and sponsors. We still believe that the Department of Labor should get some guidance up there. In fact, I think that what Mr. Chambers said about guidance that's available elsewhere could certainly help them decide what to put on their website.
Mr. Chambers,
I want to. That hard.
I'd like to follow up with you on the concerns about limiting investments and your thoughts on Congress or the federal government through rule or regulation limiting the ability for funds to invest.
Well, I would point out first that it seems that Mr. Marco probably just precluded his own defined benefit plan, if he has one, from investing in alternative investments. From what he was saying, because I suspect it would not have, at least in that example, $250 million. And that's the point. It seems to me that there needs to be individual choice that's to be exercised by fiduciaries. We have a strategy for fiduciary rules that's been in existence for quite some time. It continues to get tweaked periodically through litigation and through court decisions. But the reality is that there needs to be choice, and I think that it's incumbent upon the Department of Labor to provide guidance so that people understand what they're getting into if they decide to embark on an investment regimen that includes these kinds of investments. I don't see that there's any basis whatsoever for additional regulation or legislation in this field, particularly as you were just asking, I think, Ms. Boberg, about the fact that we're going to have a slew of information that's coming out in conjunction with the Dodd-Frank bill. And just one other point about that, which is that, and I don't pretend to be a guru in conjunction with the Dodd-Frank bill, but I would point out that as I understand the registration requirements in that bill, it is the advisor, not the fund, that would be registered. There would certainly be fund information that would need to be provided by those registered advisors, as well as perhaps, if the SEC finds the need, other advisors that are not registered. But the most important thing is that information is supposed to be held confidential. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that Congress has just acted, shortly, when the ink dries, if it's ever applied, has acted in a fashion that says, we think that imparting this information is very important, but it's to be imparted to the government for purposes of determining risk. Mm. We understand that there's proprietary information that we're probably going to be requesting. And if that proprietary information is then handed out to the general public, we Congress do not believe that that's the best way to handle it. And I think what Mr. Marco and to some extent Mr. Hutchison are suggesting in their written testimony is that there should be a requirement that a lot of that information, which is proprietary, which is private, in fact should be disseminated to the general public. And that's contrary to what Congress just decided.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair recognizes Mr. Kildee for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I've served on this the subcommittee now for 34 years. It was called a task force at the beginning with Frank Thompson as chairman, and then the task force was folded into the committee. And Frank used to say at that time that there's only one person in Washington who understood ERISA, and that was Phyllis Borzi. And I think probably the number has grown since then, but it was a very complex bill, and we were trying to address a problem that existed out there. And I want to commend you, Mr. Chairman. I've served with a lot of chairmen, and I have found none better than you, both in head and heart, because you really believe in the importance of this bill. I'd like to ask a question, address it to Ms. Boberg, and the others want to answer. It's a very generic question. If any, what is the most significant change or changes we could make to help improve accounting transparency for pensions?
I'm actually sitting before this subcommittee and thinking about fees. It's difficult for me to think about disclosure and pensions without thinking about 401k fees. I know that's not really your question. When I think about what fiduciaries need to deal with, it's a very difficult job, and I salute you. I think they need all the information they can get. That said, I think it's important to try to balance the costs versus the benefits of getting that information. So if there were to be, you know, more audited information, you'd have to think about what it would take to get that. I just did want to point out, though, that in our work, the plans that we contacted, so these are medium and large plans, virtually all dealt only with registered advisors for their investments in hedge funds and private equity.
Anyone else want to make a comment?
Yes, thank you very much. In my written testimony, I think there are four practical ways to enhance accounting transparency. The first one that I mentioned is require an audit of internal controls, and that's normally associated with the Sarbanes auditing, and you know, early on that was a significant burden to publicly traded companies, but you know, it's been 10 years. We're approaching 10 years since Sarbanes came into effect, and it's a lot easier these days to get an audit of internal controls. So, for example, a hedge fund could obtain a Sarbanes-like audit of internal controls without it becoming a burden to the hedge fund. And I do agree with Mr. Chambers. You know, the allure of the private equity and hedge funds is that there are some proprietary methodologies and knowledge and systems that these managers use, and if that got into the public, it would kind of render their business model, it would injure it. And so I think that there's a way to apply the audit of the internal controls without it becoming public like it is with publicly traded companies. So I'm not opposed at all to that line of thinking. That's the whole idea of having private equity and hedge funds available is their proprietary methods. The second one is the financial statements. They're not easy to understand. We need a summary in plain English that says this is what this financial statement means. Enterprise risk management skills, so that should be the hallmark of every hedge fund manager and private equity fund manager. These are the risk management skills that we're trying to deploy here. If we can't avoid it, we need to reduce it. If we can't reduce it, we need to spread it out and diversify it, or perhaps accept it. But there needs to be skills in managing that. And the last one is the fair valuation standards. The problem currently with the fair valuation standards, and FASB is trying to bring those into a more consolidated, tight definition, but hedge fund managers and private equity managers are able to give the CPA who's performing the audit internally and preparing the financial statements variables, which are called unobservable inputs. And they say these are the inputs that we believe will make sense to an investor and give them the information they want to invest in this fund, and then the auditor assigns the value of the fund. Well, the problem with that is there could be three or four different unobservable inputs that could materially change the value. And so those unobservable inputs, they're unobservable, hence they're not transparent to fiduciaries who need to make the decision. We need to know what those variables are. So in other words, if input A is used and the fair market value is X, what would the impact be if we used input B or C? How would that change the fair market value? I think we need to know those things.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank my friend for the very nice compliment as well. Chair recognizes the ranking member of the full committee, the organic farmer from Minnesota.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the witnesses. And Mr. Chairman, I want to congratulate you on yet again finding a witness from Cornell Law School, thus strengthening the bonds of the Cornell Law School Alumni Association. I know that's one of your—
I think Ms. Boker is actually not from the law school. Oh. We're diversifying our witness list. She's from the master's
policy
program, correct?
Oh.
This is entirely different.
This is entirely different. I take it back. I take my congratulations back.
It is.
I want to sort of pick up on some of the things that Mr. Price was asking about and the chairman addressed, and that was the issue of the timing of the 2008 GAO report, the subsequent additions and modifications that Mr. Chambers was reading last night, and the comments that a couple of you made about the financial reg bill, the Dodd-Frank bill. It's my understanding that we're in for a blizzard of rulemakings, some hundreds and hundreds from the healthcare bill that still aren't done yet, and I've been told over 300 from the Dodd-Frank bill. And so the sort of general question is, and it's to anybody who, Mr. Chambers said he's not the guru of this legislation, but anybody who has some idea of what the impact will be in this very area. I mean, we've been calling for Department of Labor to put up guidance and not regulations, as I understand the discussion here, but nevertheless, it seems to me, and that's what I'm asking you, that there could be some serious changes that come into effect when this rulemaking process moves toward its conclusion, and it might affect guidance and regulation and everything else that has to do with this. So anybody who has, who guru or not, who has an opinion on this, I'd like to hear from you.
I'm not sure what rules will be covered, but I think the issue of disclosure, and I'd like to differ with some of the comments that were made here earlier, I think the idea of saying to an investor, invest in this fund of hedge funds, I can't tell you what I'm doing, and I can't tell you what I'm holding, because that's proprietary, just trust me, but you invest in this, and that's fine. I'm not going to tell you, and I can't tell you, because this is nonsense. Why would you ask? No one would do that in their right mind. There has to be some kind of supervision of what it is you're buying, what it is you're investing in. And for us, it is not a problem. As a fiduciary on the clients that, for the clients that we serve, we demand that disclosure and we get it. We also sign.
If I could interrupt, I take your point, but what I'm getting at is, do we think that Dodd-Frank, with its hundreds of new rules and regulations, is going to affect any of your practices or any of the processes that are underway now that might affect whatever guidance the Department of Labor would put out? And so that's what I'm looking at. Mr. Chambers?
There is a tremendous amount of discretion that's been afforded to the SEC under the bill, as I understand it. And therefore, I think it's somewhat difficult to say, well, clearly we're going to have guidance on this field, or we're going to recognize a requirement to provide this sort of information. But I do think that some of the things that will happen as a result of this in connection with hedge funds, and it's not even sure whether to the extent to which they're going to cover private equity. But with regard to hedge funds is that the larger hedge funds, of course, will be providing a pretty significant amount of information, I expect, to the government. The government will be assessing that in conjunction with, in particular, the risk element of what it is that those organizations are doing, as well as working with outside accountants and things like that. I personally believe that because a number of the exemptions from registration that have existed in the past are being changed or eliminated, I think a lot of this is going to move offshore. I think that what you're going to find is that under this bill, there are a number of organizations that provide access to investments like this, which are going to try to avoid the registration and other things, or they're going to limit the amount of assets they have under management, and they're either going to move offshore or they're going to remain small. I guess the one point that I would make, though, to Mr. Marco is that I think it's disingenuous to expect that there's going to be a tremendous, or that there could be a tremendous amount of information regarding these private companies to be disseminated and to be updated, and to have those organizations be able basically to afford to provide that kind of information. And finally, and finally, there's a very simple response. Don't invest in anything where you feel that there's not sufficient information. This is the tail wagging the dog. Don't invest in something if you feel that the information is incorrect or that it's insufficient. That's what we do with regard to investments in things where there is public disclosure. Don't invest. That's what they're hiring you
for. Okay, thank you. I see the red light is on it. I think that confirmed my suspicion is that we've got a lot of rules coming and we don't know what they're going to do. So thank you very much. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentle lady from Ohio, Ms. Fudge, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank all of you for being here. My first question is initially directed to Mr. Chambers, and anyone else is more than willing to, is free to answer. Just want to be clear that, or ask if you are suggesting or if you believe that setting fiduciary standards for hedge fund managers will impede their ability to manage their funds.
I may have missed the middle part of your question. Is if we create fiduciary responsibilities for hedge fund managers?
If we create standards, which is what we're talking about to some degree, do you believe that that is an impediment for them to manage their funds just by creating the standard?
I think in large part, yes.
And why is that?
Well, as I've indicated, I think that a lot of the information that could be requested and disseminated to the public rather than kept at the government level, as it would be under the Dodd-Frank bill, is information that could be proprietary and that could therefore could have an adverse impact on how they run their fund. Secondly, I think that there is a, depending upon how much information is required, as anyone who's ever worked with a public company or who's worked with a registered investment kind of arrangement understands, there is a significant cost that's going to be associated with creating that kind of information and keeping it updated. Those are just two out of many reasons why.
So do you believe that there should not be standards for hedge fund managers?
I think that hedge fund managers, like people who operate and own any private business, do have a certain sense of standards that they need to owe to shareholders, that they need to owe to their employees, and we have existing laws that provide those standards. What I'm suggesting here is that with regard to, and that's with regard to any organization that is not publicly, where there's no public market. If an organization is going to have a public market, if it's going to hold itself out as making, as being an investment grade opportunity for the general public, then yes, there are additional standards that we as a government have imposed over the years. Those standards have never in the past been extended to private industry that is not out there seeking public investment.
My second question, and any of the members of the panel, but particularly for Hutchinson, if that's, if without additional disclosure, do pension plan managers understand the risks involved in investing in hedge funds and private equity funds? And I guess probably maybe put a different way, is it useful information or is it just more information?
Excellent question. And I think to clarify this discussion about whether proprietary information should be shared or whether, you know, the risks are understood, I think the key to all of this, and I think it's very, very important, a fiduciary has to know what's going on in the fund. So to clarify my prior statement, I'm not suggesting that alternative investments need to have all their proprietary information shared with the public. Does it need to be shared with the fiduciaries? Absolutely. There's no question about it. So, and I'm not, you know, I think Mr. Chambers isn't suggesting that that information be withheld from fiduciaries, otherwise they can't make a good decision. But the thing that's more important, the hallmark of any investment is the concept of expected return. A lot of people get nervous when they hear that, but unless an investor, like a trustee of a pension plan, can expect a favorable outcome from the investment of their capital over a specific period of time or, you know, a long time horizon, they can't really determine what the merits are of that particular investment. And so we talk about all the time, what are the risks? What are the risks? What are the risks? Well, that's fine, but I need to know what the expected outcome or expected return, which is really truly the hallmark of investing. If you can't expect a favorable outcome, the markets, whether they be private or public, will come to a screeching halt because the flow of capital will stop. I mean, are you going to give your capital to somebody if you can't expect something favorable to happen? No, you won't do it. Nobody else will either. So the real issue is what are the expected returns? And then when you evaluate the expected returns, then you have to balance that out with what are the expected risks? And that requires a lot of information. And the four elements that I talked about earlier, I believe, are the foundation for disclosing what a fiduciary needs to know and understand about expected return and expected risks. And so to tie all this together, at the end of the day, it's the fiduciary who has to make the decision. I don't think the government needs to make those decisions. The fiduciary has to make the decision, but they have to be informed and they have to understand before they can make that decision. That requires knowledge and disclosure. And so I envision that taking place between a hedge fund manager and the fiduciary in an office. They're talking about it. Things are disclosed to the fiduciary. And the fiduciary can consider it, but I'm not necessarily in favor of broad distribution of information. If the fiduciary wants it, they can get it, and if they can't get it, move on.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentlelady. The gentleman from Oregon, Mr. Wu, if he chooses to be recognized. Very well. And we'd like to thank the witnesses and the members of the committee for their diligence today, and I would turn to the gentleman from Georgia for any concluding remarks he would like to offer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I think that this has been helpful. The information that has been provided to the committee, I think, will allow us to hopefully step back and take a deep breath, wait on the SEC, and as senior member, Mr. Klein, Colonel Klein, said, the blizzard of regulations and rules that will be forthcoming. And see where we are at that point. But I think this has been helpful. Transparency is important. There's no doubt about it. However, limiting individuals' opportunities and options in terms of investing the way that they believe to be most appropriate for themselves is I think, something that is anathema to our system. And if we move down that road, then I fear that we continue to move down the road that changes the very fabric of our nation. And I'm hopeful that we do not continue in that vein. So, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity. I would ask unanimous consent that included in this hearing record be an article from the Wall Street Journal earlier this week, Congress Overhauls Your Portfolio.
Without objection.
And thank you.
You're welcome. The gentleman from Oregon informs me he would like to ask a question. I'm going to permit that, and frankly, if Dr. Price, if you would like to follow up on that, you will have that opportunity before we close. Gentleman from Oregon is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I just have one question. This hearing is focused on transparency. Most of our federal securities laws, most are based on disclosure. There are some substantive constraints in federal securities law, and state blue sky laws are more based on substantive constraints. I'd like to hear the witnesses talk just for a second about whether each of you feels that the disclosure and transparency mechanisms are in and of themselves completely adequate, or whether there is a significant role for some substantive constraints. I would view, for example, margin limits as one example, or formerly, I'm sort of remembering it as the uptick rule for certain types of sales, whether some substantive constraints are also necessary, because it may be the case that transparency alone is not enough, that the market may not be fast enough, and quite frankly, there are some things that are so complex that even a very sophisticated investor may not be able to understand exactly what is going on, even when fully disclosed, or certainly not in a sufficiently timely manner to react to market conditions. I'd like, to the extent that y'all have any comments on that, I'd be very interested in your comments.
First, I would say that disclosure does so much of getting you along that path, so that the investor knows what it is and how risky and how much leverage is going to be an investment. All of the things I've talked about today, to correct some of the other comments, are being done today. They're best practices of managers who are doing it. I'm not suggesting inventing something new. There's an organization called Institutional Limited Partners Association with hundreds of members who've agreed to these best practices. So it's not like asking people to do something that is a burden. This is what the best investment firms do. Now, to your point, when they disclose and the investor can see the amount of risk taken, it will give people pause and not perhaps choose not to be invested in one of these things. If they can get the information to know what it is they're doing, they may choose not to. I think down the road there may be some room to say that there may be some limitations on the kind of things that these investment vehicles can do. I sort of suspect that the reason that the SEC hasn't done a lot in this area is because, to a large extent, they don't understand them. They don't have the staff or professionals in there to understand all of the complex things that are going on within these hedge funds. And as they start to improve their experience and learn more about it, they may say, well, there's a limit to how much leverage we can do, that someone could put on something. But unfortunately, the deal with hedge funds is they're by nature very complex, and they are trading in very complex ways, which, and leveraged, which makes them very risky. Which says, first of all, the investors ought to know what the heck they're getting into when they purchase, when they use this investment manager to make these kinds of bets. But then for someone to come in and say, okay, in doing these complex strategies, only 2% of this and 5% of that, gets to be pretty difficult. And I'm not exactly sure how. I mean, I'm sure there are some areas that could be done, but I think you get much further down the road by saying, explain what it is you're doing, give detailed information to fiduciaries, not published in the public record, but to the supervising fiduciary, to say, this is what we're doing, show us your position, show us your leverage, so we can understand what you're doing, get you a long way to helping fiduciaries handle these kinds of assets, rather than have to set borders on the individual strategy.
But just following up on that, there may be, in your view, some mechanisms which are so inherently risky that once understood by the SEC staff, that one may choose, as a matter of public policy, to take that mechanism out of the toolbox because they're inherently too risky?
That's possible. Mm-hmm.
If I may also just comment, one thing that comes to mind is naked short selling. You know, that not only I think that that shouldn't exist within qualified retirement plans, number one, because of the risk that it creates, not only for the plan, but also as a systemic risk. You know, failed naked short sells create a systemic problem that affects other hedge funds, other pension plans. So when you said, is there something of substance that you would limit? I would say, you know, if a plan is considering a hedge fund or some type of investment philosophy, I would personally ban naked short selling. I won't buy knowingly anything that has exposure to failed short sells or other systemic risks like that.
May I just take one moment? Congressman, I think that your question requires taking a step back. because it's not just a matter of deciding what needs to be restricted. I think it's a question of weighing the rights of people who are putting together a particular type of investment and the rights of people who are thinking about investing in that investment. And as I mentioned earlier, and I think you were not here at the time, if you're going to be making public, if you're going to be making public opportunities available, then I think as a matter of public policy, yes, there's a lot of information that needs to be required. On the other hand, these most of these private equity funds and certainly hedge funds are private arrangements. They are contracts between investors who want to find out as much as they can about those investments and the people who put the investments together, the managers or the advisors, who decide how much information they wish to provide and how much they do not. And I think that the weighing of this now is, are you going to be taking what is now available only in conjunction or required only in conjunction with public investments, publicly traded investments, and are you going to be making some of that required for private industry? And that's an enormous step. And the question is, as I mentioned earlier, isn't the answer to this that someone's willing to give this amount of information, and if the person is not willing to make an investment based upon that information, they don't have to make the investment? Why is it that pension DB plan fiduciaries should have a right that perhaps is greater than investors who are investing for themselves or who are investing for college endowments? These are willing buyers and willing sellers, and I think that what you're asking is that we might be interested in making some of these disclosure requirements much further downstream than we've ever considered doing before.
Well, there are some transactions that folks might be openly going into that we banned for other reasons. I mean, we don't permit someone to sell themselves into slavery or to do a murder contract. I mean, those are extreme examples, but you know, in all the market or the transactions that you're talking about, whether in an open market or not, they have by their nature some impact on folks who are not parties.
Agreed. Gentleman's time has expired.
It's all about Price, risk.
If there's any closing comments, I will again thank the witnesses and the members of the committee. When the discussion that Mr. Hutchinson theorized takes place in an office where a fiduciary for a divine benefit plan or the representative of the fiduciaries is meeting with the representative of a hedge fund or private equity fund and discussing whether or not to make an investment, obviously the people who'd receive the pension from that fund have a vital stake in that discussion. But there's also a silent partner in any one of those discussions, and one way or another it's the taxpayers of the United States because of the PBGC and the role the taxpayers, I think, ultimately have in standing behind the PBGC. In my mind, this leads to one conclusion and then a series of questions. As I said at the outset of the hearing, I do not embrace the proposition that protecting the taxpayers requires precluding investment in these classes of assets. I think the opposite is true. I think that a fiduciary who diversifies is a more prudent fiduciary than one who doesn't. So I think making these classes of assets fully available to defined benefit plans insured by the PBGC is entirely appropriate, and I would not favor anything that restricts that. A series of questions that are raised, though, are, do these decisions take place in a context of adequate or desirable transparency? Do the fiduciaries have access to comprehensive, relevant, real-time information to help them make these decisions? I don't know the answer to that question. I think that's a question that ought to be looked at. To the extent that there is not access to relevant, adequate, real-time information, what conditions might create the environment where that is the case? Clearly, a pension fund with a robust balance sheet is in a market position to demand such access or not make the investment. And I do think that's the most powerful way to avoid this problem, the most powerful antiseptic to any toxic that might toxin that might exist. The question becomes, what, if any, steps are appropriate for us to take to create that environment? These steps range from perhaps simply of making more education more available to more fiduciaries on a basis of education, ranging all the way from there to legal changes that would require such disclosures. I find myself this morning in a position that's agnostic on that question. I think before one answers the question of whether the law should require more disclosure, we have to get to the issue as to whether disclosure is adequate or inadequate in the first place. And I would hope that the committee would pursue that question. Again, not so that we might necessarily lead to a legislative proposal or a regulatory one, but so that we can assure that the best quality of transparency is available in every one of these transactions. And it's sort of an implicit answer to Mr. Chambers' argument, which I think he makes very persuasively. The reason that that defined benefit plan trustee may have some right that is prior to some of the other investors that you mentioned in your last comments is that the taxpayers are underwriting that decision in a way they are not in the in at least some of the others that you mentioned. So there is a public interest here in trying to prevent yet another bailout, yet another financial disaster the taxpayers of this country would be called upon to address. I think that the defined benefit system is a success, and I think the record will show that investments in alternative investments have been a success by and large. And I think that the last thing in the world that we want to do is micromanage fiduciary decision makers around this country. What we want to do is create an environment where those fiduciary decision makers have adequate access to adequate, relevant, real-time information so they may do their job and be held to the high standard to which the law holds them today. You, ladies and gentlemen, have given us much food for thought. You've given us a lot of excellent information. I'm sure that we will be calling upon you again as we deliberate on this and other issues. And without any further ado, there's a script that I have to read, Tom, to end these proceedings, which I can never memorize. Without objection, the members will have 14 days to submit additional materials or questions for the hearing record. Without objection, the hearing is adjourned.